Day everyone, and once again back together. Okay, looking at question seven, based on acids and bases. I'm sure this has now become your favorite section, right? Okay, so if you haven't subscribed, just make sure that you hit that subscribe button. And for those of you who need assistance, of course, with mathematics or physical science, you're more than welcome to just get in touch with us. And our email address is info@mlungisinkosi.co.za. All right, so let's have a look quickly at that question seven. So they give us sulfuric acid that ionizes into two steps as follows. So there's the there's the ionization of it. Okay, they say define the an acid in terms of the Lowry-Bronsted theory. Remember, according to the Lowry-Bronsted theory, an acid is simply just a proton donor. Okay, so yeah, if you want to make it, to add volume to this, you can say it's a proton donor in the presence of a base. Okay, right, so it is simply just a proton donor. Right, and then they say write down the name or formula of the substance that acts as an ampholyte in the above equations. Okay, so I want you to just look at it. Okay, so if you look at in the first reaction, okay, so you've got H2SO4 becoming HSO4 minus. Okay, so what actually does happen, this is a reversible reaction. All right, is that here HSO4 minus, in the reverse sense, now can react with an H plus, or rather can receive an H plus and become H2SO4 again. But also HSO4 here, gives away an H plus and becomes SO4 2 minus. Okay, so in this case, so the correct answer to that would be HSO4. They say write down the name or the formula. Okay, I would stick to the formula. Okay, so I'd say for 7.1.2, that would be HSO4 minus. Okay, right, and just keep in mind that if you wanted to go with water, that wouldn't be actually a fact, right? Yes, water is an ampholyte, okay, but in this particular reaction or in the above equations, it does not act as an ampholyte. Okay, right, they said give a reason. Okay, so you can say that it acts as an acid. It acts as an acid and a base. So basically they wanted you to state whether you understand what an ampholyte is. Okay, so it acts as both an acid and a base, right? I think it was incorrect for them to actually give you single arrows there. Okay, but nonetheless, it is what it is. All right, so 7.1.3, they say the conductivity of solutions, HSO4 minus and H2SO4 are compared. Which solution will give a lower conductivity? Now, what we would do to check that conductivity, you can look at the Ka value, okay? This is what we call the ionization constant, all right? Now, think about Kc, the normal Kc. So this tells you this Kc is, it's actually 1000. So it's telling you actually it's going by the droves, to favor the forward reaction. So there's a large ionization of this here, okay? But when you look at this now, you get 0.01. So it does not ionize that easily in that case, okay? So definitely sure, in this case, they said the conductivity solutions of HSO4 minus and H2SO4 are compared. Which one will give a lower conductivity? So definitely it will be that of HSO4 minus. Okay. So it will be that of HSO4 minus. Okay, right. So why is that the case? Okay, so in that case, we get a value, the Ka value, okay, is lower. All right, and the lower the conductivity, it means that it does not ionize easily. Okay, so the lower Ka value, okay, so the lower Ka value indicates that it ionizes poorly. It ionizes poorly, right? Okay, and in that case, it means that obviously there'll be less ions. So less ions are formed. Okay, and as a result, so with less ions, it means that it will conduct less electricity. So conductivity, conductivity will decrease. Okay, right. Yeah, I'm trying to explain in a way that makes sense to all of us, but nonetheless, you can find ways in which you can also explain the same thing. Obviously, you can even check the memos later and see if you know, they kind of indicate the same thing. Right, so the next one, they say the pH of hydrochloric acid. Okay, now we're back to our normal selves. I'm sure you're happy to come back to this one. Okay, so they say the pH of a hydrochloric acid solution, HCl, is 1.02 at 25 degrees. They say calculate the concentration of hydrochloric acid. So we know we've got the pH this time, and we're looking for the concentration of hydrochloric acid. But remember, we know that pH is equal to minus the log of our hydronium ions, okay, H3O plus or H plus. But if we want concentration of our hydronium ions, H3O plus, this is going to be 10 to the minus pH, and our pH was given as 1.02, okay? So I am actually going to calculate that. So that's 10YX minus 1.02. Oh no, 1.02. Okay, and I get a value of 0.095. Okay, so I get a value of 0.095 moles per cubic decimeters. Now, please keep in mind, I have not calculated the concentration of hydrochloric acid. I've only calculated hydronium ions. But because I know that hydrochloric acid ionizes by forming, for every one of that, there'll be one of hydronium ions formed. Therefore, I can say that it means the concentration of hydrochloric acid should also be equal to 0.095, of course, assuming that it ionizes completely, moles per cubic decimeters. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. Right, the next question, all right, so it's one of those, and I'm sure that you guys aced it. Okay, they say the hydrochloric acid reacts with sodium carbonate according to the following reaction. So there's our reaction there. Now, they say 50 cubic centimeters of hydrochloric acid, okay, is added to 25 cubic centimeters of 0.075 moles per cubic decimeter sodium hydroxide. And then they say to us, calculate the concentration of the excess hydrochloric acid in the new solution. So what does, you know, what seems to be the case here is that all of that hydrochloric acid was not necessarily used up. So some of it was left. So meaning again that sodium carbonate would be the one that limits the extent of the reaction. So what I'm going to do is let's find out the number of moles of sodium carbonate, okay, that we have in that reaction. So okay, so this is 7.2.2. So I'm going to calculate the number of moles of sodium carbonate. Okay, so Na2CO3. Okay, so the number of moles of sodium carbonate, I've got the concentration and I've got the volume there. Okay, so number of moles would be concentration times the volume. So I'd say 0.075 multiplied by the volume. Okay, I'm going to keep it in. Okay, so let's convert it to cubic decimeters. So this would be, if we divide 25 by 1,000, that would be 0.025. Okay, right. So what does that give us? And I get an answer of 1.875. Okay. Times 10 minus 3, and that's moles, right? So this is our limiting reagent, right? Now, what I can do is, now, let's try to determine, if I have those moles of sodium carbonate, how many of hydrochloric acid am I actually going to use? Remember, we still need to find out how many we had in total, right? But now I want to find out how many would actually react with that sodium carbonate. So I'm going to use my ratios here and say, look, for every one of that, I get two of hydrochloric acid. So in that case, it means if I use this amount of sodium carbonate, the amount of hydrochloric acid would be twice as much. So therefore, the amount of hydrochloric, the number of moles of HCl, I'll say that I used, okay, would be equal to twice the amount of sodium carbonate. Of course, that's a 2-to-1 ratio. So that's 2 times 1.875 times 10 minus 3. And I'll just multiply that answer I have by 2. And I get an answer of 3.75. Times 10 to the power minus 3, okay, and remember that's in moles. Okay, so that is the amount of hydrochloric acid that we used. Okay, so now that's not what I'm looking for. However, I want to find out the amount that will be left of hydrochloric acid, the one in excess, right? So in this case, I've got the one that I've used. Let's find out the total or the initial amount of HCl, right? So I'll say the, so this would be HCl, okay? So initial, the number of moles that we have initial, okay? So remember, we now have the concentration and we're given that volume of 50, right? So this would be concentration times volume. So it would be a concentration is 0.095, okay, which we found there, multiplied by the volume, which is 50 cubic centimeters. So that's 0.05. So let's get that there, 0.095, okay, multiplied by 0.05, okay, so I get an answer of 4.75. I hope you are still following, ladies and gents. I really try my best to explain this in a way that does make sense to all of us. Okay, so this would be 4.75 times 10 minus 3 moles. Right, now, what am I looking for? I'm looking for the excess moles, the ones that are left unreacted. And it only makes sense in this case. And I mean, I did advise you even before the exam, you know, for those of you who haven't watched our videos on, you know, acids and bases, please do so, because I explain these questions in a very easy way. So in this case, I would say, well, it means that the excess moles, okay, would actually be the ones that we started with, the initial ones, minus the ones that we used. Makes sense, right? So we'll take the difference between those two, 4.75 minus 3.75, and that should definitely give us a 1, right? Yeah, it should give us 1 times 10 to the power minus 3. Okay, so those are the excess moles of acid. Okay. Now, keep in mind, we're looking for the concentration of it. So now what we're simply going to do, okay, just going to look for some space here. So concentration, remember, this is number of moles divided by volume. So we're going to take the excess moles, which is 1 times 10 to the power minus 3, and we're going to divide by the volume. But please keep in mind, in the new solution, what did we do? We added the hydrochloric acid to the sodium hydroxide. And what would be now our new volume? It would be 50 plus that 25. I hope you understand that. Okay? Because remember, we actually mixed the two. And so this excess happens when the mixture has happened. Okay? In this case. So that would be 75 cubic centimeters. But of course, we divide that by... we divide that by 1,000, okay? So concentration in that case. So that would be number of moles divided by that volume, okay? So let's say divide by 0.075. And in that case, I get a value of 0.013, okay? Moles per cubic decimeters. And essentially, that is how we answer this question, ladies and gents. I hope that you were able to get all of those marks. All right. And essentially, that is it. And I'll see you guys again next time. Sharp, sharp.